So we're going to start with our announcement of our Spanish language translation services. And our Spanish language translation. There you are. Thank you.
Hola, buenas tardes. Soy Irma Pulido y estoy aquí para traducir para quien guste mi servicio. Aquí estoy. Gracias.
Muchas gracias.
Buena suerte.
Our first item is a motion for, or is a potential approval of the minutes from our regular meeting of September 3, 2019. Is there a motion to approve?
I move to approve.
I'll second.
Thank you. All in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Minutes are approved. The second item is approval of the minutes of our informational session on September 17, 2019. Is there a motion to approve?
I move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 The third is approval of the minutes of our special study session on September 17, 2019. Is there a motion to approve?
I move to approve.
Second.
All in favor?
Aye.
Aye.
And then the final is approval of tonight's agenda for our October 1st, 2019 meeting. Is there a motion?
I move to approve.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Aye. Okay. I did actually not ask anyone to prepare a norm for tonight, but I will do so because I didn't ask anyone to do it. So the first one I'm going to do is our first norm, which is unity of purpose. We keep the district focused on learning for all students. And it is our pole star in everything that we do, so it seems an appropriate one to do tonight when we're bringing someone new into the board. So, okay. Now we will take communications to the board from the public on items not appearing on the agenda. So if it's anything concerning what we're discussing tonight, please not at this time. Thank you. Mr. Brown.
Good evening. Ken Brown, City of Sonoma. I'm with the Sonoma Valley Housing Group. We're very interested in what the school board is doing. A lot of opportunities for teachers here in Sonoma Valley. My daughter Eden's a senior at the high school this year, my fourth child at the high school, and she absolutely adores it. So it takes after her mom. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown.
Dawn McIntyre, teacher at Dunbar, parent since 2003 and employee with the district since 2006. As the public would not be aware, but the board members and cabinet would, I sent a letter earlier today that I took a few days penning, and it's with deep concern that is completely emotionally based for what is happening within our district. Elizabeth, thank you for all your help. Andrew Ryan, thank you for your assistance. Socorro, I definitely have to say that over the years I have been heard, and I appreciate that. However, there are things that are not being heard, and I'm hoping that our new members will help. Whichever woman is chosen, I adore you both. Best of wishes. We still have fire damage at our school. We are the only school who incurred damage. There is a burned section to the side of my school that was painted over but never repaired. I have part of a sandbox with no sandbox and no news as to whether or not we will ever again have a sandbox. And at this point, the quarter of the sandbox which was left is becoming dangerous for children because they jump on and off of it, and it is breaking and getting worse. We had a special need full inclusion child last year peeling the bubbling paint off the wall, and we had to make sure he wasn't ingesting it. That has yet to be fixed. I could go on, but I don't feel the need to stand here and put myself above anybody or throw anyone under the bus. I truly love the people with whom I work. So this is not meant to make disparaging remarks on those people. But when you feel as if a 12-year period has come from Atlantis to the sinking of Atlantis, and you can only tread water for so long, people who are beaten down, no matter how loud their voice is. My husband recently made the comment, do they think you're Chicken Little and that you're just screaming that the sky is falling? Are they not listening to you and hearing you? And so most days I'm angry and frustrated, but at this point I'm just sad. I'm not giving a letter of recommendation or resignation at this time, but I am looking for employment out of this district. I've worked in private sector and I've worked out of this district. And the level of cleanliness of our classrooms for our children and for the teachers is better. There are things that are handled differently and less hostile working environments. And I feel bad for people like Andrew Ryan who have to hear formal complaints rather than doing something before that gets to that point. Thank you.
Thank you. And again, this is a time for public comment on items not on our agenda. Thank you.
Hello. My name is Carolyn Niehaus. I teach at Altamira, and this is Becky Fitch from Adele Harrison and Altamira, or Adele Harrison and Sonoma Valley High School. I just wanted to take a few moments to say thank you for supporting our annual retreat to the Casadero Music Camp for Sonoma County Jumpstart Weekend. This was this past weekend. Casadero is located in a redwood grove near the Russian River. This past weekend, we had the opportunity to collaborate with 92 middle school students, 16 high school mentors, and 14 chaperones, three of which also played instruments and helped throughout our rehearsals, and seven different music teachers from across our county. 20 students represented Sonoma Valley Schools. We got to focus on making music in the forest without distractions of cell phones and internet. Students learned seven pieces of music in 3 days for a concluding concert. At the concert, one of the directors asked the concert band to raise their hand if they had learned something over the weekend. Everyone raised their hand. Not only did the middle school students have the support of each other, their teachers, and their high school mentors, but the teachers had the opportunity to observe each other working with the ensemble in rehearsals and borrow tricks for the trade for our own classrooms. We had everyone fill out a survey at the end of our weekend, and we asked the campers to convey what their Jumpstart weekend experience meant to them. They were given a sentence starter, CAS is. I will share one of the responses from one of our Sonoma students. CAS is a way for me to be expressive through music. At school, I am constantly trying to be socially compatible while being an introvert. People want us to act a certain way, to wear credible clothing, and to have a certain attitude. People in our society don't realize that a voice is larger than your appearance. Casadero is my voice. It allows me to express my reality and my voice. Thank you, a Sonoma student. This is a seventh grader, mind you. Casadero Music Camp is near and dear to both of us because it is where we decided that we wanted to become music teachers. It is so rewarding to bring our own students to the camp and watch them find a deeper appreciation for their craft and become inspired to continue in music. We look forward to having the same opportunity for many years to come and continue to support students attending during our summer sessions as well. I have copies of our program from the weekend for each of you, and I just wanted to say thank you again for supporting music in our schools.
Thank you very much. Please.
Good evening, Gina Kuklis. Just to remind you who I am, your representative on the Sonoma County Board of Education. And I want to encourage you, I'm here to encourage you to attend the October 17th Legislative Day with all five of Sonoma County state legislators will be there. You should have gotten multiple email invitations about it from Dr. Harrington, but I'm here to remind you because this is the second year we're having a day with, well, Last year, we had four of them. Cecilia Aguilar Curry, our assemblywoman from Sonoma, couldn't make it. But this year, all five of our state legislators will be there at noon. We scheduled it at lunch this year, hoping for, because most of our school board members do work during the day, that that would make it easy for administrators and school board members to come. I really encourage you, besides the fact I feel personal ownership of this, because it was an idea that I brought forward a few years ago to have this event, instead of just one-off that we were doing with bringing one legislator at a time to try to have an event, and we're all there, and we have a strong voice of education leaders in Sonoma County. So I did not see anybody from the Sonoma Valley Unified School District Board last year. So that's why I'm here, because I want to see attendance from the board. And the new, whoever is seated tonight, I'll also make sure that you get the information about this event. Thank you.
Celeste Winder's parent. I'm also the one of the co-chairs for our Special Education Advisory Council. So two things on the SEAC, and I just want to remind the district in general, and hoping that some messaging can be sent out regarding outdoor education and field trips and our special education students. This is the time of year these things come up where students are not attending outdoor ed and not attending field trips and being told that they can't or that they can't have their aid or those types of things. And I want to just remind the district that under IDEA, what a student has in their IEP also applies to outdoor education and field trips. And it's very, very important that the case managers are reaching out to parents and setting up IEP meetings or making the arrangements for that to happen, instead of putting it on the parents to have to figure out 2 days before the field trip that their kid can't go, and suddenly we don't have an aide, and suddenly we don't have this and that, and then the child doesn't end up going. This happens every single year. Every year, I have a parent contact me and tell me their kid can't go on outdoor ed because they can't have their aide. And that's against the law. And so I just want to remind district of that, and I want to remind caseworkers that they need to reach out to those families. The other thing I want to say is I really feel what Ms. McIntyre was saying. I am a Dunbar parent. I've been a Dunbar parent for a really long time, and I'm also a Dunbar alumni. I'm 47 years old, so you can do the math on when I went to Dunbar. And doesn't look a whole lot different than when I went there that long ago. Because Dunbar has been in a state of disrepair and neglect, and it has been the school that this district consistently forgets about and pretends just isn't there. We have been screaming for a decade that we need support and we need help and we need resources, and it has fallen on deaf ears. We have been ignored, and now suddenly, because we've been identified as required under Every Student Succeeds Act, Dunbar was one of the 781 California schools under comprehensive support and improvement as one of the lowest performing schools in the state. And now there's funding attached to it. And now all of a sudden everybody's looking at Dunbar saying, what's going on over there, you guys? Why are you so low performing? We've been trying to tell you for 10 years that we need help. So this is not a new thing that we suddenly need resources and assistance. I'm glad people are paying attention now to Dunbar, but please keep paying attention and please listen to our educators and our parents when they are telling you we need help at Dunbar. We are a beautiful school. We are a beautiful school community. We have one of the most beautiful campuses in this town. We also have one of the most beautiful communities at our school. And we have sustained because of us, but we cannot sustain it by ourselves, and it requires the support of administration and it requires resources.
Thank you. Any further? Yes. Mr. Hansen.
Hello, Peter Hansen, Sonoma Valley High School. I'm back. Odds are you're going to be seeing me again at the next one, probably with some students, which is always a pleasure, and probably with some teachers. I'm here to speak about campus beautification, the improvement of our schools, not just Sonoma Valley High School, but all the schools. I have to echo, we've gone so long with so little, and we need to dig out. That's going to take an extraordinary effort. So, for example, the janitors, 2.5 janitors for the last 2 or 3 years, a lot of stuff piles up. So I did walk the campus recently with Bruce. I found him very amenable, He's very strategic and good with solutions, and I was very pleased. So am I seeing progress? Yes. Am I seeing some cooperation from the district office and from you all? Yes, I'm seeing that. I'm getting the emails that say, how can we help? But we really need action. I'm a teacher. I have 165 kids. Come on. Now I'm doing this on top of it, and I'm happy to do it, and I just can't run point on it, but I will be your point person as long as you'll join me to get the job done. We need our cleaner campuses. Our floors need to be better, et cetera, et cetera. So thank you for listening. Thank you for amenable solutions to getting it done. We're talking about short-term money to bring in some of our janitors in on a Saturday for a work party. Let's bring back the students for student labor on weekends. Let's dig out of the last few years and let's brighten up our campuses. It improves the learning environment, it improves the culture, it makes everyone feel better. And it's what we should be doing because it's the right thing to do, and we can do better. We can do a lot better. Keep our campuses clean, keep them pretty, keep our students happy, and be nice to us next time we come up. Okay? Thank you for your time and your attention.
Kindergarten at Prestwood School, and I have a lot of random things that I need to mention. At Prestwood in particular, we need a health tech. Our community liaison cannot do her community liaison work because she's being a health tech right now. The new student study procedures that we've been hearing about, it's my understanding that the first meeting is called a CARES team meeting, and that meeting does not include a teacher in that meeting, which doesn't make any sense to me. The teachers work directly with students, so it seems like a teacher that's representing that student should be at that meeting. Last Wednesday, we met for the first time in district grade level meetings at Flowery, and our meeting consisted of inputting scores on a spreadsheet for Bridges, and then we were told at the end of the meeting that data would not be used for anything. And then the next day, our principal logically asked for that information so that she could look at how our students are doing. And she was told that what we were told is that we aren't really going to use that first assessment. I think we need to relook at what the topics are going to be for the following Bridges grade level meetings for elementary. I know the math leads did their best coming up with ideas for what we can work on this year, but I think it needs to be looked at again because teachers don't want to spend time in meetings filling out spreadsheets when we could be working on helping each other implement the curriculum well. The high turnover rate with the administration at the district office level makes it very difficult for us to have consistency and a continuum of plans from year to year. One example, Prestwood last year when we had our own site meetings for working on Bridges, we were looking at promise standards and how to meet the students' needs for getting them to learn what they are supposed to be learning. And now the focus looks like it's supposed to be on these number corner assessments, which don't necessarily match up with the promise standards. So we need consistency, we need a continuum with plans, we need teacher input on decisions that affect students and teachers, and we need better communication. I'm hoping for a little bit smoother year next year. I know this year with a lot of change, Prestwood had 8 new employees this year. It's hard to have continuum and consistency with that, but I'm hoping that it will be worked on this year and that it will be highly improved for next year.
Hi, Ronette Weston from Sassarini. Wasn't going to come up here, but I'm one of the math leads she was just speaking about, and I'm extremely heartbroken, and I'm really sorry because that was not what was supposed to happen at the Bridge Day. definitely was not supposed to be said. But as far as our school site goes, and I think our district goes, we need to have a newcomer program for our elementary students. There's, I think, about a dozen now, and I have one in my class, and I can't speak to him because I don't speak Spanish, and by code, I believe, he's supposed to be taught in his native language, his reading, and his math, and I cannot do that. So please, and also, we need a vacuum cleaner. Our custodian has no vacuum cleaner in the district. He was told by someone at the district office to buy our own at our site, and I don't think it's our site's responsibility. So please, a vacuum cleaner.
Hi, Helen Marsh. On the theme of campus beautification, I ran into somebody at the I noticed just from walking my dog through the campuses, they just didn't look the way you would want them to look back to school. So, and I know it's not because our employees don't work hard, because they do. But back during the measure, well, let me start with the red and white ball. I talked to the person who designed signs for every school in the district, and Britta was very actively involved. This was during right about the same time as the Measure E campaign. And she volunteered. She did a beautiful job. She's the same person who designed the new dragon, also for free. And at the red and white ball, she said, when are those signs gonna go in? And I said, that the signs were canceled a year ago. Nobody told her. Nobody had even had the courtesy to thank her for her hard work and tell her that it was all for naught. And I think that's unfortunate. I think it's unfortunate that we don't have standardized signs. I think in addition to a branding issue, which is a phrase I probably learned from Britta, it's also a safety issue. Because when you're trying to find your way to a school and there's not adequate signage, it can make it difficult. And I, as I recall, it was not a big ticket item. So I would defer to what, I mean, I think clean classrooms, clean bathrooms, and Dawn's TK class is way more important than the sign program, but the sign program would come from bond money, and that was always the intention. So I would hope, Britta, with your previous, and this was when you were working on the banners that were so lovely. And so it was all part of a theme of being a unified district, putting our best foot forward, helping everybody in our community know that we're one school district, and now that's gone by the wayside. But I particularly was upset to hear that this volunteer who spent a considerable amount of time on these various projects was not advised of that, and that's just, I think, inexcusable.
Janet Hansen, high school librarian, English department co-chair, and a site rep for VMTA. I think maybe you can hear a theme in a lot of these comments. We had a VMTA meeting on our campus last week, and I had been feeling particularly, as some teachers are describing, as if I was having a really hard time getting any kind of support above the level of my department, getting any action on requests or needs that I had expressed. And we went around the room at the high school, and I heard teacher after teacher, where we usually talk about a salary or hours, saying, it's like we're on our own. Emails don't get answered. Questions, you can't find the answer. Budgets, you can't find out what they are. Teachers feel like above the level of our colleagues, our system is broken. And then we had a VMTA meeting, and I realized it wasn't just the high school. Every school went around and said the same thing. We don't get answers. We don't get action. We don't know what's going on. We don't know where these plans come from. We have concerns about plans. We don't know where they go. So I want to tell you that we have a lot of hopes and ideas about change as a district. But this is what I hear from teachers all over the district. they're saying, I'm just hunkered down. I'm just keeping my head down. I'm just going to weather this because we don't know where things are going, who will be here, how things will come out. So the way things are right now, people don't feel supported, and I don't think that they're going to, I don't think that they're going to take a risk to bring about change. So I hope that we can raise awareness of that and maybe make some change.
Thank you.
Hi, everybody. My name is Brandy Melendi, and I'm a teacher at Dunbar Elementary. And I just wanted to also give some suggestions based on the complaints that you're hearing from teachers. We feel like we have to advocate for our students, and we know what they deserve. And I just feel like there's an underlying lack of perhaps evaluation and retraining in certain areas regarding maintenance and custodial. While we appreciate those who help us at our sites, there isn't evaluation or training for those individuals. And so I think that that could really help our situation. I also wanted to be given an opportunity to talk about how amazing Dunbar School is. I'm thinking I would probably do it when we talk to our new representatives or our candidates here. Is that right? Should I do it then?
Oh, you're not allowed to talk? Can't talk about items that are on the regular agenda in this section of public comment. So it.
Okay. So wait. Yes. Wait. I'm going to wait. Okay.
I'm Stuart Saunders, a father of an Adele eighth grader and a Sonoma Valley junior. In response to the district's EIR request for the high school fields, I did some research. I believe with the right data, we can build fields that are safe for our children and our community. At the meeting concerning the Altamira field, I was shocked that the vendor's presentation didn't cover any of the issues that I had found in my research. There was no mention of fire dangers posed by a plastic and cork field without a watering system. MRSA was said to be no more of a concern than natural grass. Injury rates the same or better than natural grass. I continued my research. The field at Adele presented an opportunity to collect data on artificial turf performance in our valley. Since April, I've been taking afternoon temperature readings at the Adele field and the natural grass field at the high school. Before sharing the data, I'd like you to look at the poster showing the stages of heat stress. At the bottom is green, the temperature that your body's child is always trying to maintain. As the outside temperature increases, usually the body adjusts, cooling itself through sweating and increased breathing. Acclimated, hydrated, well-supervised athletes usually have no problem getting cooled down. If this is not the case, or the child has complications due to medications, heat stroke can begin at 103 degrees. 911 should have already been called. At 104 degrees, permanent damage of internal organs can begin. The child needs aggressive treatment in a hospital. At 108 degrees, death occurs. Now, the data I recorded, there are only a few natural grass readings down on the left because the temperature on the grass field never got over 93 degrees. That's because it's self-cooling. It aspirates moisture to cool down. Artificial turf, on the other hand, collects heat. The artificial turf temperatures were always well above 100 degrees. Contrary to the vendor's assertion that artificial turf only gets 20 to 40 degrees hotter than natural grass, data showed that it could be as much as 67 degrees hotter than natural grass. Natural grass does not pose a significant threat to our children's body temperatures. Artificial turf, on the other hand, creates a harsh, intensely hot environment that children should not be exposed to on a regular basis. The boy in the picture, Zach, a high school football player, is only one example of a child who died of heat stroke. Unfortunately, his death represents attitudes of parents, coaches, and school boards that it won't happen here. At the hospital, Zach's mother asked the doctor, "Will he be able to play football again?" The doctor answered, "We're just trying to save his life." They couldn't. In September, a soccer player collapsed from the heat stress. A Napa soccer player collapsed from the heat stress on the artificial turf field. The high temperature that day was 84 degrees. He was rushed to the ER, and luckily he survived. Three high school football players on average die each year from heat stroke. Let's not let that happen to any of ours. Both trustees Blake and Coleman have seen the heat differences and other issues firsthand. I extend the same invite to trustees Johnson, Kelly, as well as our new board member to meet and walk the fields together. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Saunders. And thank you for your long work on this issue. We all appreciate the fact that you put in a very significant amount of time.
Hi, Mindy Luby, parent, also co-chair of SEAC. And I'm kind of impassioned by what it is that you're saying because I have a child with special needs. One of the things that we do as SEAC is try and bring the lens of special education to the overall lens of what we do for all of our kids. Most of them fit in the box. And I can tell you it's really sad and hard to watch children when they start to have problems. I have a child with Down syndrome, and on warm days, it becomes really apparent how difficult it is for her. We have brought her to the ER before. She loses her ability to hold her urine. She will poop in her pants, and she gets super, super sick and begins to vomit. It's really ugly, and it's for her, it's not, it doesn't happen. It happens more quickly than it would with a typical child, a neurotypical child, a child without disabilities and medical problems. But if this is a conversation that we're going to have and that we can go backwards, I don't know where we're at even with the fields, if it's something that we can talk about. But I've stood up here before and said it before, and I really encourage that we do think about these children because it means that I will not be able to bring my child onto the field. I already live a life where I don't go places where normal families go. I'm not a normal family because my child has Down syndrome. She has medical concerns. And when it's too hot, when it's too cold, when it's too loud, we don't go places. And this will be one more place that I cannot bring my child. So if there is an event on wherever this is, the high school, I'm not going to be able to bring her during certain days, or it's a whole nother concern that I have to now take into account. So it's just a perspective from a family that actually lives it. I recognize and I appreciate that most people do not have to think about these things, but I would really ask that you do consider that when you are thinking about the overall picture. Thanks.
Is there any further public comment on items not appearing on our regular agenda? Okay, seeing none. There's no further, Mr. Ransom, I think there's no further public comment on items not on the agenda, but if you'd like to speak to us, you may.
I'm Dave Ransom. I live in Santa Rosa. I go to church in Sonoma. I'm a member of the Sonoma Valley Housing Group. We have communicated to the school board and the administration that we support district elections for the school board. In Santa Rosa, I've gone through the process of watching the push to have district elections in the city council. And the first attempt was a referendum, and I saw the opposition to the referendum saying, protect your vote up in the hills. And coming from Virginia, I recognize code when I hear it. Protect your vote was, we need to be able to elect all of these folks. It was up to an out-of-town attorney to force Santa Rosa at its cost to have district elections, and in 2020, we will have three board positions on the west side of 101 coming up, on unfilled positions, on new people. So, as a housing advocate, I understand the importance of having people who actually walk the walk, doing the talking, making the decisions. It's a matter of fundamental democracy that we do that. And I think it's the same with the school district. We're very much interested in housing concerns for the valley as a whole, and that's for the need for students and for their parents and for teachers and staff. And it seems to me that we're going to get a stronger response out of the board when people feel like this is our board we elected from our district. This is a question of community. City Council in Sonoma keeps talking about community as if it ended at the borders. And of course, we know that the Springs actually has more population than the city, let alone Temelec and the East Side, right? Okay. So we're very interested in y'all's coming up with district elections. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Ransom. If there is no further public comment on items, Mr. Castillo.
So I am also a member of the Sonoma Valley Housing Group. I'm one of the individuals who signed the letter and addressed the letter to Mr. Kelly. So I would appreciate if the board acts on it as soon as possible. Thank you very much.
Thank you. Seeing no further public comment on items not appearing on the regular agenda, I'll close that portion of our agenda. Okay, so the next item that we have on our agenda is our consent agenda. The purpose of the consent agenda is to act upon routine matters in an expeditious manner. The items listed are usually considered routine and are acted on in one motion. It is understood that the administration recommends approval of all the consent items. There is no discussion of items unless a member of the board or the public previously requests removal of an item to be inserted at an appropriate place on the regular agenda. Each item approved by the board shall be deemed to have been considered in full and adopted as recommended. Is there a motion for approval of the consent agenda?
I move to approve the consent agenda.
Second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
Aye.
Great. So this brings us to our regular agenda, and the first item we have is we take our reports, and our first one is our student trustee. Sir.
Let's see how this works. All right.
Ooh.
All right, so basically the biggest thing that we have going on for the month of October is that we have homecoming going on. And the big thing is that this year we really wanted to open it up to the community a lot more than it has been in past years. One step we're taking towards that is that we're gonna take Float Fest, which has typically been a student-focused activity. And what we're gonna do, we're gonna push it up an hour so that it starts at 5:30, ends at 8, so that it happens in the light, the entirety of it. And we're gonna open it up to community members to come in, walk, you guys can see all of the floats before the actual homecoming parade, which will be, So this is Thursday, October 17th, 5:30 to 8. We're gonna have some food trucks there and there will be music playing. The day after, which is October 18th, around 1 o'clock, there's gonna be a rally in the plaza where we're gonna be showcasing all of the homecoming candidates. Again, open to the community, and then at 7 p.m. that night will be the homecoming football game. So we really want to extend the welcome not only to members of the board, but to all of you guys. Please come support the high schoolers. Just try and have some fun, I think. Hopefully these floats come out pretty well. So another thing that we have going on is that Ms. Kelly O'Leary, with a group of her students, is working on a proposition to City Council to enact the Green New Deal resolution. So a group of them is working on climate advocacy and trying to petition the City Council, which I think is great. I've been working with them a little bit too, and it's going pretty well so far. And lastly, we had Club Rush on Friday, and that was pretty much all the students coming out, and they signed up for a bunch of clubs. We had huge turnout, so I was really excited to see that and see a lot of student involvement in the school. And yeah, that's about it for me.
Justin Hollander, VMTA. Good evening. After 2 months of representing VMTA, after 2 months of meetings and conversations about data, about moving forward, about adversity, meetings where our moral obligations are shortchanged by legal obligations, meetings where the idea of systematic shortcomings keep coming up and the need to address them. After attending various meetings with the entire DO staff over the past month, meeting with a couple of board members, and meeting with community leaders and members of the Ed Foundation, I have concluded that we are well-versed in conversing about the problems. Action seems to be eluding us. We are paying almost $3.4 million this year to consultants and private contractors to help identify and band-aid the legal and glaring problems that exist in the day-to-day business of running our school district. We as teachers, and worst of all, our students, are paying for years of systematic miscues, site turnover, and leadership position turnover, which results in the loss of institutional history and knowledge. We are also paying a cost that does not show up in one of Bruce's spreadsheets or in any of the student data we analyze in redundant data systems that scores get inputted into and we pay for. It's a cost that's not even quantifiable. It's the elephant in this room. It's discussed in various ways in site meetings, whether school-wide, grade level, or department. We are suffering from a lack of social capital in this district. Speaking for VMTA, this is a cost whose effects can be felt on every campus in this valley. Its effects are felt and seen when change is presented or solicited. It is felt in the deteriorating relationships between staff and administration. We are not unified. We are not united in collective missions or objectives. We suffer from a lack of common understanding and norms, and we don't believe that the current structures or leadership provides ideas to bridge the divides between sites or repair the trust between sites and railroad. The status quo is not working. Our current systems, or lack thereof, aren't working. The lack of social capital stems from years of poor decisions, the lack of accountability, and the consistent change that is still occurring. It stems from choices and decisions that this board and previous trustees have made. Why has turnover been so great over the last 2 years? Why are people leaving? It's not just the money, which, by the way, dissuades potential applicants and encourages people to take their talents elsewhere. It leaves us short of subs and qualified special ed applicants. People are leaving due to the loss of social capital in this valley, and as a result, the cost of this turnover continues to perpetuate our problems. These problems, like the enormity and diversity of our student issues and struggles, can't solely be solved by bringing in consultants and outsiders. We need to invest in ourselves. We need to invest in our students, especially our growing ELs and underserved special ed populations and the countless families who have left for alternative options. We need to acknowledge the elephant in the room, that this leadership team needs to do more to find a way forward. We can't just keep meeting. We, as VMTA, need more. Our students and families deserve better. I'd like to conclude my remarks this evening saying there's finally a contract posted online for our members, our admin, and the community of reference, and VMTA is looking forward to negotiating with the district in good faith to address the plethora of issues that divide us rather than unite us. We look forward to learning how SVUSD plans on reinvesting in the deficit of our social capital.
Thank you, Mr. Hollander. Ms. Hernandez?
Good evening. I am Terry Hernandez, Office Manager of Creekside High School and CSEA Chapter President. I'm here to represent all the classified staff. At the last board meeting, I let you all know that the classified staff has been running the IT department. It has been a full year since we lost our last IT manager. Bruce Abbott has been acting as the IT manager until a new manager could be hired. This has been a cost savings for the district, I'm sure, but sometimes penny wise can be pound foolish. There has been some issues since the beginning of the school year with PowerSchool and Blackboard Connect to 19.2. That needs to be done when you upgrade your system. It's the IT manager's responsibility to anticipate the extra workload to start off a new school year. Did you know the district went from 4 to 29 software programs with no additional staff to support the workload? Isn't this the responsibility of the IT manager to distribute the workload to the IT department and be aware that there is not enough staff to handle that workload and to make sure the work can be completed in the allotted hours of the workday? If the acting IT manager had actually been well aware that there was not enough help in that department. I looked up the definition of manager. It's a person responsible for controlling or administrating all or part of a company. Instead of hiring more people, Bruce went after our classified staff, stating they weren't doing their jobs. Really? Wake up, school board. People are leaving this district because of the administration. People work for Sonoma Valley Unified District not because of the money. They work here because it's home to a lot of them, because they care about this close-knit community. They go to school. The district leadership is trying to implement PBIS, Positive Behavior Intervention Systems. Positive behavior and employee morale comes from the top. Positive behavior needs to be modeled. Why don't we start there?
Thank you, Ms. Hernandez. And if we could please have our superintendent's report.
I want to first thank everyone for coming tonight and acknowledge the comments we've heard, and I look forward to following up with staff as we not only talk about what people are experiencing, but we look for the actions we'll take together to move the district forward and solve these problems in the light. I want to thank everybody for their back-to-school nights. We finished those, and they were all quite well attended. Staff was exemplary, and we're looking forward to gearing up for our first round of feedback with parents around both meeting them, telling them how their students are doing them, and giving them individual feedback on students, which we don't do at back to school night, which is a rather kind of high overview. So we look forward to that time with parents and sharing personal information with their students and their growth. This Saturday, we're going to have a study session. The board will have a study session looking at student data, looking at our LCAP, really grounding our work, and what will we be doing to move the district forward. So thank you.
Okay, we'll now move to our first item on our regular agenda.
John, excuse me, point of order, please. I noticed that some things have been moved on the agenda, and so I just want to check in and acknowledge to the audience that trustee reports have moved from the beginning of the agenda to the end. So I'd like to know why that was done, who made that decision, and then I'd like to know in terms of information staff reports if we are actually going to have a chance to hear them as an information item or if they're just placed in the back of the packet to be read. Thank you.
So the point of order is always a point that takes priority over all other matters. So of course I'll address that right away. So the agenda was proposed and we all voted and approved it, right? Which did list that we would do the trustee reports at the conclusion of the meeting. And that was my suggestion because I thought that we should first do the appointment of the new trustee, which I thought would get more people present in the room, and it was the pressing business of the day. So it was my, I did that.
So it's just for this one meeting? It's not going to be all of the time?
I did just do it this one time for that specific reason.
Thank you.
But if it works, maybe we'll do it. But I think we should see how it goes tonight, right? If it turns out that it's not in the interest of our deliberations and we should move it forward, I'm fine with having it earlier in the agenda too.
And the information staff reports, they were, in a normal meeting, they would have been items. But because we couldn't tell people when we'd get to them, and they usually have other people here presenting, we decided to do this and pull them from actual agenda items and let the item number one take precedent of the evening so that people could go home. And
so if we have questions after having read them, we can ask to have them agendized?
Absolutely.
Thank you.
And I think that is the intent going forward, that we may actually have some items that we present as informational that trustees may then request be a regular agenda item. Because there's some of these items that we want to discuss, but it's also good to make sure that we don't keep some of the staff here until 10 or 11 o'clock at night if we're not gonna.
Right, I just wanna be sure that the public is aware when we make those changes and the rationale behind them. So thank you.
Thank you, Trustee Blake. Okay, so this will bring us to our first agenda item tonight, which is the appointment of a new Dunbar trustee. We have Mr. Carl Corbin present this evening. Mr. Corbin, would you like to give us a brief on this before we begin?
So at this point, good evening, board members, public. So at this point, the trustee, previous board president, has resigned effective this morning. So you have an open position, as we've been talking about. The board can choose to go and either order an election, which would run about $100,000, and go forward to the voters in March 2020 and serve until the November election. The board chose to go forward with the appointment process. The board opened that up to applicants. There was a time period for that. My understanding is a number of individuals applied, but then at this point in time, there's only two individuals who are asked. All the discussion from the board, all the questioning is all in open session. There's no closed session deliberation. The questions are in open session. Your deliberation, most importantly, is open session. As far as the student board member, the board can allow as much discussion or involvement as the board would like for the student board member. The student board member does not vote on the appointment of the individual. I was asked to, my understanding is Catalina Wetzel and Jessica, Catalina?
Yes.
And then Jessica Strachan. My understanding is you are the two individuals here. This is an open meeting, so you do have the right to stay in here during the open meeting, but I would suggest, if you are willing, that both of you do step out and then have, while the other person is being questioned, that you step and stay out of the room. You're not required to do so, but that does allow more. You don't have one applicant staring at the other applicant. So that is your choice, and if one of you wants to stay in, then I would have then advised that the other stay in also. I was also asked to go through and randomly decide which, through a random process, decide which one of you would be questioned first. And the Jessica, Ms. Stratum, got number one, and then you got number two for that. The board's process is, there is in the agenda, there is a list of draft questions, as you'll see at the end of this agenda item. There's 10 different questions. The board can go through and ask those items. The board can choose to add additional questions. I would encourage the board to ask both applicants all of the same questions. But again, you can deviate through this process. You are a four-member board at this point in time. So that means that when you do the vote, you're going to need to have at least three board members. Hopefully you can make this unanimous, but you need to have at least three board members vote on an applicant. If the board chooses neither one of the applicants, which is a possibility, that the timeline, as we've already described, is vastly quickly approaching, and if the board does not take action, then that goes to the county superintendent to order an election, and then that authority will be removed from the board. Does the board have any questions?
The one issue that's out there is that there are a significant number of members of the public that are here present tonight that I believe would like to speak on this item. And the issue, I think, is that they would like to inform the questions that we as the board will ask the applicant. And because we were going to be asking exactly the same questions, my understanding is that it would not be proper to allow the public to then ask questions of the applicant. So it seems that we should take public comment before we decide on what the questions are. Does that seem to make sense?
Yes, it does, because again, you're not going to want to go through have a continuing public comment. But I think for the board, at this point in time, to hear from the public on their questions, their interest, seems completely appropriate. And then after the public is done, the board from there can take that input appropriately, develop your questions appropriately. Then you run through the whole process, ask the questions, do the deliberation. And then hopefully you're going to have, for your next action items, you'll be able to swear in a new trustee.
Are there any questions from the board at this time?
I just want to ask, we don't have to ask all of these questions. We could eliminate them, but we all have to agree on that. Is that right?
You are the board. These are the questions in the packet right now, but you can absolutely eliminate any or all these questions, and you can go and add additional questions, but then that is going to be something that at least three of you are going to need to agree upon. And with the vice president acting now as the president, because the president has stepped down, will be guiding the process for the board.
Okay. And if we end up in a 2-2 vote, is there, can we deliberate further to come to a, see if we come to
the
a decision?
The board can stay as long as it would like and deliberate as much as it would like and take as many votes as it would like. And you're either going to reach at least a three person majority, or if you can't reach action on this, ultimately, again, the county superintendent will order an election.
Thank you.
Okay, seeing no further questions from the board for Mr. Corbin, I was going to take public comment now. So members of the public who'd like to address us on this item, now would be a good time. Thank you.
Hello again, my name is Brandy Melendi. I've been a teacher at Dunbar for 15 years. I really appreciate your willingness to represent Dunbar's community. It means a lot to us. I just thought it would be important to tell you a bit about our amazing country school. Dunbar is a very special school. That's why I've been there for 15 of my 20 years. We're about 58%, roughly, this is estimated, 58% English language learning community. 82% of our students qualify for free and reduced lunch. We are unique because we have two severely handicapped classes and a very inclusive campus climate. We are the oldest elementary school in California. And we're a small country school, an amazing, beautiful campus. The teachers at our site are the best, in my opinion. We have a completely open door policy, a really devoted staff. And what makes us unique is we're an AVID school, advancement via individual determination, K through five elementary school. We also, in the fourth and fifth grades, have developed a multi-age program that we love and embrace. And we have an amazing garden and art program. We want our representative to report out, hopefully, ideally, at each board meeting about the great things that are happening on our site. So we really hope that you will feel invited to be present. I also thought it'd be important to tell you that when I first came to Dunbar long ago, there were close to 300 students. And so now we're, you know, below 200 due to declining enrollment, as well as some tricky boundary changes that have happened. And I hope that in some capacity you have been involved in Sonoma schools, whether it be as an involved parent or perhaps, I'm hoping that this isn't your first board meeting either. And I just wanted to say thank you. Did I forget anything, Don McIntyre?
Mrs. Melendi, who I love, said that we are a K-5 school. We're a TK-5 school.
TK, you're so right.
So our transitional kinder is a little bit interesting as well. Elizabeth Kaufman has really tried to help over the last year period for a smooth transition from the preschool into the TKs and Ks. Has gotten us some really great curriculum. And some of the things that you need to know is that we are essentially an overflow school for Flowery. And Flowery does not have a TK program. Also, Kenwood does not have a TK program. So what has happened continuously over the years with my TK class is that I lose 2 to 5 students who go to Kenwood or Flowery after they have learned their ABCs, their sounds, their numbers, their potty trained, and then they leave. So our declining enrollment has some, you know, other things caused with that. In addition to the 2 SCO classes, children who have speech problems like my son and or dyslexia are not best candidates for a two-way immersion. So we also have a higher general population who are in speech and RSP than some of our other sites due to that. Just to be aware.
Thank you.
Far be it from me to suggest two people who are as careful as Ms. McIntyre and Melendi are out of order, but if we could try to address all comments to the chair instead of to the candidates, in theory that makes our meetings run better. I don't know whether it does or it doesn't in fact, but we try. But thank you very much for, thanks
We're
guys.
The rule breakers.
You are never the rule breakers.
Celeste Winters, I'm a Dunbar parent, also a Dunbar alumni. I was a demon before we were dolphins. It was appropriate. I just want to convey to the board how incredibly important it is to us as a Dunbar community that we have a trustee who is active at our school. While I understand that the trustees sitting up there make decisions on behalf of all the children in our valley, it's still important that there is a connection and an advocacy and an understanding of the district in which you represent. And we have not had that. And I'll just go ahead and be the bad guy in the room that says it. We have spent over 10 years with a trustee who has virtually ignored us. And we see rarely, sometimes, but only at the happy events, not when things get real tough. And that's been really disappointing at a school who really could use some support and to feel supported. Our teachers laid out our demographics, and I think that that's one of the things that makes us special, is we have this incredibly beautiful student population, but who need people who think outside the box supporting them, and we have teachers who think outside the box who support them every single day, but we need trustees and administrators and an entire valley that can support our out of, well, many, many of our out of the box kids. When I was a Dunbar kid, we were very much out of the box just because we were like little feral Glen Ellen kids. but you know, we've always been a little out of the box at Dunbar. But it's really important, and I don't want to see a situation where Dunbar isn't the priority in that trustee's eye as a place to be and a place to be connected with and a place to speak up for and to listen to our teachers and listen to our families. I often say if anything ever happened to Dunbar, if you guys ever had any inkling of closing it, I'd chain myself to a tree, and I very much mean it. I would totally chain myself to an oak tree out there. I love that school very, very much. I love it as an alumni. I love it as a parent. I love the teachers there. I love the community there. I love the other parents there. It is a very happy place to be. I am graduating my very youngest child there. but I'm not going anywhere. I will always be a Dunbar parent. I will always be a Dunbar alumni, and I will always advocate for that school. So whoever sits in this seat, just know that you're going to be spending a lot of time hearing from me. I'll do my best to be as polite as I can, but if I don't feel like Dunbar's being heard and getting what they need, I may not be polite. And I want to see the school get everything that it deserves, and I want to see the teachers get what they deserve, and I want to see those kids get every single thing that they deserve, because those are some amazing kids at Dunbar.
My name is Stacy Derrickson, and my daughter goes to Dunbar. I am married to a Derrickson who spent 25 years straight at Dunbar Elementary School. My daughter Lucy has Down syndrome and is fully included, which is something that I have fought. And I just want to echo what Celeste says. I didn't go to Dunbar, but the traditions and the uniqueness of the school is really, really important to the parents and the teachers at Dunbar. And we want somebody that's going to help continue that and to listen to us as parents. Advocating for your child is one thing, but absolutely having to kick and scream for your child is another. And it's really difficult when we're trying to do it by ourselves and it falls on deaf ears. And we have amazing, amazing teachers who are fighting the good fight at that school. But like Dawn said, they're going to give up their fight if something doesn't change. And we don't want that as parents. And we want a board member that will help to help advocate us to make that school what it used to be, and district-wide too. But we just want it to be the same that it's always been. So thank you.
Okay, seeing no further public comment, we'll bring it back. Oh, Mr. Ransom.
Fifty years ago, when I was a graduate student at Stanford, I lived in East Palo Alto. At that time, it was unincorporated, and It was majority black, and it was part of San Mateo County and part of a congressional district that was in San Jose. It had no representation in the Palo Alto City Council, and it was connected with the city of Atherton for their education, so you can imagine that the Atherton folks controlled the school board. I want to put in my two cents for the importance of having Latino representation on the board. I'm sure that both of these candidates are well able to do the job that they're volunteering for, but as the person said, we have 58% of English language learners in Dunbar, and it's time for to have some more Latino representation. That would be, one hopes, the effect of district elections, but part of getting to that point is showing that Latinos have a place, Latinas have a place, in the political life of the community.
Mr. Castillo.
Mario Castillo, Parent. So I want to obviously echo what Mr. Ramson just stated. I also want to echo a lot of the things that have been said by the parents from Dunbar. But I also want to remind the board about the importance of this, of appointing someone to this position. And I also want to remind the public that we have the power to make that decision at the end of at the end of the year, really. If whoever the board chooses tonight doesn't turn out to be the right candidate, we can change that. And in fact, the board was, I think that was doubtful of having enough interest for this position. And having four qualified people apply for this position speaks of how engaged and how concerned this community is on the issues that were brought up actually during the reports by the Teachers Association President, Mr. Hollander. So I think that this is key. But I also also like to remind ourselves that we also have a responsibility to keep the board members true and honest. And it is also our responsibility to remind them of their job and their responsibilities, really. So I'm hoping that the two candidates tonight are committed, understand the challenges that the district is currently facing. I'm hopeful that they're doing it for the right reasons. I do have someone, you know, that I would prefer personally, but I want to remind ourselves that, you know, it's part of our responsibility too. The fact that this district hasn't gone well, we also share some responsibility for that, for failing to attend board meetings, for not holding the board and the cabinet accountable and the administration as well. So let's keep that in mind. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Castillo. Is there any further public comment? Going once. Okay. So we'll bring it back to the board. And at this point, our job would be to refine the questions. And Mr. Corbin, I think we actually have to have you come stand up here so that your voice gets caught by the microphone. If you can help us through this, that'd be very much appreciated. So my sense of this is that if there are any questions that anyone would like to propose at the start, this would be a great time to do it.
I'll go first then. I think there's a few too many questions, and questions number 2, 7, and 8 seem like they're more questions for board members, not for people who are coming into this process. I mean, they seem pretty advanced questions, so I just question whether those are really appropriate questions to ask people who are seeking the office. And also, I think number 9 is kind of vague.
comment. So I think at least the beginning part, the tell us about yourself, is a repeat of what was in the written application. And I know that all of us read the written applications probably more than once. And I will second Kathy's comments on questions 7, 8, and 9. I would be fine striking those questions. And then question number 6 is also already in the written application. So unless if someone feels strongly about any of these questions, I'm just saying that I would be okay striking the first part of 1, 6, 7, 8, and 9.
Yes? Ready? Okay. I feel pretty strongly about number 9, so I don't mind looking at rewording it. But for me, the whole idea of equity for our students and our community is important. I feel like it's part of our values and belief statements, and so I would like to keep 9 in some form. And interestingly enough, I felt like number 5 was a question that I wouldn't mind omitting. I don't know that anybody knows what they're getting into, especially when you're walking into an appointment in the middle of the whole shebang and it's up in a year. So I don't know how influential an answer is going to be to their thoughts about running again after a term at this point. So I wouldn't mind dissing out number 5.
Could you give me a suggestion of how we might reword number 9?
Kathy,
I was just going to say, I think it's okay as is. It's just vague. And that might be okay. I mean, I can live with the question.
Well, it looks like to me that if you want to strike 7 and 8, guys, I'm fine with that. So let's just consider those struck. And then I think that my sense is I would keep 9 as well. I don't necessarily want to re-wordsmith it, but I think let's just keep it because I do hear that. Then on the first part of 1, we just struck the first sentence. Are you okay with it then?
Yes.
Is everyone else? Okay.
I can go with it, but I actually think that hearing something verbally from people is different than reading it on a piece of paper. So I actually would like to keep number 1.
So we'll keep that then. Okay. Regarding question 5, I'm actually a little bit in agreement as well. Would you?
Me too. Okay, I think it should be struck.
We'll strike 5. My sense is that we want to hang on to 6. I hear you, Ms. Johnson, about that, but what I'm hearing from the other trustees is they kind of like to see it. And I mean, it's a, okay. So, and then the only other one that's left would be number 2. And I hear you, Ms. Coleman, saying that a recent board decision, that's kind of it's sort of like an existing board member would answer that question, right? But I mean, I don't hear anyone else wanting to strike it.
So I actually think that the value in that conversation is less about the recent board decision and more about, you know, this position is really like no other. Mm-hmm. And the listing of things that are being balanced in all the work that's being done, mm-hmm. that doesn't happen in any other kind of position in the district.
Yeah, I think what we're looking for is the second part of the question, not necessarily a board decision, but just imagining that maybe if we just slightly changed it to how would you work with a difficult decision, and how would you discuss it and all the rest of that.
And we could leave it up to the individual if they want to use an example of a recent decision, or if they felt more comfortable with something else that happened in their maybe work life or other life. Would that work?
Would it be possible to just begin with describe how you would discuss a vote on an issue of importance to you?
Yes.
And then they can choose an issue if they're interested in giving an example.
So I'm gonna write it down or type it in so I make sure I get it right for both. So it's gonna be describe how you would discuss.
Discuss vote on an issue of importance to you.
And then continue the remainder stem of the question. So working to balance.
Just leaving the first nine words out.
I can do that. Great. Okay. So I think that gives us question one, and we are now going to include the first sentence. We're going to strike the first nine, actually 11 words of question two, question three unchanged, question four unchanged, strike question five, ask question six, strike seven and eight, and then ask questions nine and 10. Okay? Great, okay. Done.
And as a reminder for the board at this point, I suggest that the two applicants, if you're willing.
Yeah, we're staying.
We don't, yeah.
Okay.
So, John, before we start, since there's seven questions, could we maybe just finish up with, is there anything they'd like to tell us that we haven't covered?
Yeah, sure, a catch-all.
Yes, thank you.
And can I make a point of order? I'm freezing. I think the air conditioning is blowing entirely on me. So if someone knows how to adjust that, at least turn the air conditioning off, that would be great. Thanks.
Best point of order I've ever heard. That's fantastic. Okay. So with that, Strachan, if you would like to come on up. So I'm going to suggest that there's eight questions now, and there are four of us. Why don't you start?
Good evening. Thank you so much for being here.
Thank you for having me.
I will go ahead and read the first question out loud. Please tell us about yourself and why you want to be a Sonoma Valley Unified School District trustee. What would you like to accomplish as a board member? Describe your highest priority and why it's your highest priority.
It's a three-part question.
Yeah. You want me to start? How about if I just give you one piece at a time? Would that be easier?
Okay.
So you get to hear the whole thing,
okay,
and
yeah,
now I'll break it down for you.
Okay.
Okay. So the first part was, tell us about yourself and why you want to be a Sonoma Valley School trustee.
Okay. Well, I am a mother that is lucky enough to have the good fortune to work part-time, and with my rest of my time, I like to help children. That's what I like to do. And so I did a very narrow but very deep volunteerism at my school. And when my job changed and I was actually in the county on Tuesday nights, I have been watching you guys. And I thought I would really like to help all the kids instead of the 265 kids just at my school. So that's who I am, and that's why I
started.
Thank you.
And then the second part is, what would you like to accomplish as a school board member?
Well, it sounds like there's a lot to accomplish. But at the very beginning, I really think that the most important thing is trying to find some common ground so that the teachers and the children and the admin and everyone is working together as best as possible. And perhaps that's going to take a lot of research and reading and finding out the history and where things went sideways and getting deep into budgets. But that's a lot of what that takes sometimes, just to do that.
Thank you. And then the last part is, can you describe, please, your highest priority and why it's your highest priority?
The students are the highest priority, always, for everybody. That's why everyone's here, and no one would be at this meeting if they didn't know that that's what we're all, you know, an unhappy child is an unhappy family, and so we gotta make sure that it works for everybody.
Thank you.
Okay. That was number one.
I think it's shorter, I promise.
problem. Okay.
This is the rewritten one. So describe how you would discuss or vote on an issue. It can be a passport decision, or it can just be an issue of importance to you, or maybe a challenging issue to find common ground on. Working to balance your values, the community concerns, the student needs, the state and federal law and staff and budget considerations.
You mean take something that you guys have been working on?
It's up to you. You can choose to take something we've already worked on or voted on or that we're actively talking about. You can just give us an example of how you've done this in some other venue. What we're really looking for is the balance of your values.
I do have to stop Ms. Johnson, though, because it's just the question as it is on the sheet of paper that we have to ask. It's literally that.
Okay. All right. Procedural. So let me back that up. See, I shouldn't have done this one.
Do you want to swap?
Yeah, I do want to swap.
You
I don't want to do this
I'll
one.
I'll take number two. Describe how you would discuss slash vote on an issue, working to balance your values, community concerns, student need, state slash federal law, and staff slash budget considerations.
I'm trying to think of an issue that I would talk about right off the top of my head. You mean like how would I vote on how to spend the money for all the different schools? Anything?
I can't ask you anything more than that.
I just really think that the most important thing is to take all of the schools into consideration with every decision that you have to make. And I mean, I think that it's really probably tricky to be sitting up here. On the other hand, there are a lot of children who are counting on your decisions. So just research. And more research is what I basically do. I'm usually come prepared. Can't come prepared to this. and that's what I do. I just try to do my homework and come prepared.
Okay. Mine is number three. With respect to community concerns, how would you balance the voice of your trustee area constituents with your fiduciary responsibility to all students in the district as a whole?
Well, I think that you guys are all trying to do that all the time anyway. I mean, that's your job. And you try and balance the budget, and you try and make it work so that we don't lose any more teachers. We want to have more teachers here. We want more people to live here who want a happy community. I think it's really tricky. I'm really worried about our budget. I'm really worried about our schools. I've gone to 4 different back-to-school nights, and there are a lot of things to celebrate, but there are also a lot of things that really were like a punch in the stomach, and our kids deserve more than that. And I know that we don't have the greatest funding in our state, but there are other districts that are doing a lot more with the money that they have to work with, and I hope that we can turn it around and do the same thing.
I'll take number 4. What unique skills, experience, expertise or perspective would you bring to the board that you think may now not exist?
Well, I don't know all of your skills and expertise individually, so I can't say that. I can say that when I moved here in 2003, I joined the Junior League of Napa Sonoma, which is a 100-year-old organization that trains volunteers, and the most important thing about their mission is it helps women and children. So it didn't really get to be written up in the paper because things got all messed up. My bio and another applicant's bio all got, pretty soon I was on a board I wasn't on and whatnot. But anyway, what wasn't put in the paper or I didn't have space to write about was I spent my first 10 years here before, and overlapping with when I started the school, working with partnering, I should say, with lots of different nonprofits in Sonoma County, not this valley. So I worked with Grandparents Parenting Again, and the Kinship Center, which were really incredible when it was relatives who weren't expecting to have new kin in their family, and we would throw Christmas parties for them. I was with the Valley of the Moon's Children Home, and we would do the Halloween party at the Hood Mansion before it was too dangerous to go into, and teach the kids thriller routines and that kind of thing. I worked with Voices, which is the children who are emancipating out of foster care, and that's the worst day of their life, and now there's a place for them to go get help. So I've always tried to be there to help. And then I got my own kids, and on the first day of kindergarten, there was one of those flyers that came out, and it said, what are your volunteer skills? And I checked the box that said fundraising, because I used to be a big fundraiser at Junior League and do a lot of auctions. And so then that's where I've been for the past 9 years, nonstop fundraising. And the reason I was doing so much fundraising, I think, is the same reason why all of you guys are sitting here. And that is because I want it to be the same for everybody. I want all the kids to go to the beach. I want all the kids to, I'm going to write grants to get all the kids to Safari West. One summer, I even figured out how to fund the whole summer school at Woodland Star because I was afraid the kids would be watching TV. I want all the kids to get to the snow in Mount Lassen. I want all the kids to have the same equal experiences. Education is the great equalizer, and however we have to do it, we're going to do it. So if it takes, you know, me spending 25% of my family vacation time, I'm happy to do it, because that way all the kids get to have the same experience. So that's me.
A comment was made earlier that this question might have appeared in the application in some form. So what do you see as the area most needing improvement in the school district?
So, I'm not sure exactly how to rate most, but I understand that we have a very serious problem with the ESL kids not testing out as soon as it could be possible, with perhaps not enough attention being given to these kids earlier for various reasons, so that they are still in the program in eighth grade when we should really be trying to get them through and helping them. You'd never not give services in any other way to children for anything else. It should be at the forefront of what they're doing in every single school. So I think that's a major problem. And I think that the teachers are burnt out and not being paid enough. That'd be number two. And I could go on. He added something there. I think that we have to spend a lot of time figuring out what's wrong at every single school, and figuring out where children are slipping. Special ed, and I hear many names, but I hear the stories every single day of what these kids and what the parents are dealing with. I feel like there are different needs at every different school. And we have to make it so that it is really the right of every child for a great education. We owe it to them. And our schools, it's tragic. I went to great public schools growing up, and it doesn't have to be like that. It's not fair for one person to have that and not everybody else. So let's try and do the best we can. That's how I feel about that.
All right. Describe how you prepared for this process, and do you have any additional questions for the board and superintendent to help you prepare to take on this commitment, if chosen?
I prepared for this. Well, someone who had worked on the Dunbar District Trustee Nicole's campaign a long time ago, after she heard about her stepping down, she wrote me the next morning, and she was like, hey, want to come and help out? And I thought, well, yeah, I'll totally help out. I don't work on Tuesday nights, and I've always been interested in what's going on over here. So I immediately wrote you guys a letter. And then I was like, well, how many of those back-to-school nights can I check out before before they're over, and it was inspiring, and I encourage everybody to go to them, because the AVID program, every single school, whether they're in that program or not, the children should be announcing what year they're graduating from college. I thought it was brilliant. I've heard about kids who are already telling their moms where they're going to college. I loved it. I toured Altamira. I've written down so many things from Ms. Paul's class that I learned in just 2 seconds there. And I went to, of course, I went to my children's 10th back-to-school night. I knew that one pretty well. And then I went to the high school, and that was really eye-opening, too. I loved listening to the new principal and sitting in the classes there. So that's how I prepared for it. That's what I do, research.
I read it exactly. Is there anything we have not covered that you would like to tell us?
I don't know. Anything you guys have not covered tonight, ever? Just, you can't answer that, huh? Okay. I just want to let you know that I'm enthusiastic, and I'm curious, and I believe in research and preparedness. And when I'm committed, I am all in providing support at every level. My interest was immediate and my commitment steadfast. And I have learned just the beginning of what the Sonoma Valley Unified School District challenges, opportunities, and culture are. I look forward to learning and listening more. I was here on day one, just like I was at my children's school, and I'm here tonight as a district parent with the same mission as the board, which is for all of us here to educate and inspire all students in every classroom, in every school, with every opportunity, just like you guys. Thank you so much.
Thank you very, very much. Ms. Wetzel?
Hello, everybody.
And we'll go in the same order.
Good evening, Catalina. Oh,
sorry to interrupt. I think we should break it into three parts again, the same way we
okay.
did.
So for the first question this evening, I'll read the whole thing.
Sure.
And then I will restate it one bit at a time. It's a three-part question. So in its entirety, tell us, please, about yourself and why you want to be a Sonoma Valley Unified School District trustee. What would you like to accomplish as a board member, and describe your highest priority and why it is your highest priority? So, first part, tell us, please, about yourself and why you want to be a Sonoma Valley Unified School District trustee.
Great. Well, I'm Catalina Wetzel, and I was born here and went to public schools through kinder all the way through high school, and then attended Santa Rosa JC. I have two lovely boys. One is special needs, and my oldest has gone through general ed, and it's been a really positive experience. I know that sounds interesting to a lot of people, but I would say that the reason why this is important to me is being a child born and raised here and gone through the public school system, and also experiencing that with my kids, I know the ins and outs and what we need.
Thank you. And then the second part is, what would you like to accomplish as a board member?
I feel there's quite a bit of things to accomplish. I would love to connect the Latin community with the board. I believe there's just a big disconnect, and also in special ed. And I feel that communication is the key.
And the last part, describe, please, your highest priority and why it is your highest priority.
My highest priority, I would say, helping the English learners and parents understand the process of helping them pass the standard testing, because I know that's a big area that we're lacking in. And most of them don't even tell their parents that they're behind on their credits until 5 months before they graduate. So I hear that those comments a lot, and it's very stressful on the family, especially a Latin family that has no idea about the district of how they work.
Describe how you would discuss slash vote on an issue. Working to balance your values, community concerns, student need, state slash federal law, and staff slash budget considerations.
That's a tough one. I believe that you just gotta really bring it in and really be true to yourself and to the student, and take in consideration everything. Every school has a different problem that we have to work on, and I think it takes a lot of consideration with the board and the community.
Okay, with respect to community concerns, how would you balance the voice of your trustee area constituents with your fiduciary responsibility to all students of the district as a whole?
I believe all all students are very important, and I think balancing would take a lot of concentration in particular issues that are being asked of us. So I think it's just a lot of consideration on the particular subject that we're dealing with.
What unique skills, expertise, experience, or perspective would you bring to the board that you think may not now exist?
Well, I'm a Latina woman in business in this town, and I have done quite a bit on educating the high school. I have helped develop a pathway to success, so the students of the high school come to my salon, and I assist them if they feel that there is a lack of maybe not going to college. I bring them in and I help them just brainstorm that there are other options, whether it be running your own business or the beauty industry or accounting or merchandising. So I've done that, and I'm on the board of the Mentor Alliance, serving 2.5 years now, and before that I was a member at the Boys and Girls Club. So I have a big experience on being a board member and a trustee.
Let's see, I think I'm up next. This question, I think in some form, showed up in the application, so you may recognize it. What do you see as the area or areas most needing improvement in the school district?
I would say the standard testing for our children. I know, we're up there. The percentage is lacking that they're not passing, especially the English learners. Once again, I would love to assist in that and, help bring that together.
As you know, a district core belief is equity. Our job is to support all students to reach their potential. Would you speak to what this should look like in your view?
Can you repeat that again?
Absolutely. As you know, a district core belief is equity. Mm-hmm. Our job is to support all students to reach their potential. Would you speak to what this should look like?
Well, I believe we should support always our children, because our children come first, always. And I think we have the ability to do that. I think our school system is really set in place. We just have to tweak it a little bit. And being a part of this community, I see a lot of little holes, but they're not big holes. They're fixable holes. And I think that there's a lot of potential. And it just takes the right board, the right members to bring it all together. And once again, I believe communication is key. Bringing the board together with the community is what I would say would be one of the biggest things.
Describe how you prepared for this process, and do you have any additional questions for the board or the superintendent to help you prepare to take on this commitment if chosen?
How I prepared? I believe I've been preparing since I started the school system back in kinder and all the way through, not knowing that God had this place for me. Last year, I didn't even think I would be standing up here. But I believe that God puts things on your path for a reason. And having a child with special needs and also a child in regular mainstream and bringing those two worlds together has really prepared me for this position. And I believe I bring a lot of assets to the board in regards to, what I've experienced through my life. And like I said, I feel that there is a lot of positive in our school. I love Sonoma Valley, and that's why I continue to live here. That's why I continue to support our public schools. I've done a lot of fundraising, Boosters Club, Ed Foundation. My business donates to every school in this valley. And I do it because I love it, and I see a lot of potential. And if there was more people like us, instead of focusing on the negative, focusing on the positive, we would have a great valley. And yeah.
Oh, okay, last question. Is there anything we have not covered that you would like to tell us?
I think you guys are doing a great job. I know this is tough, and it's not easy. And me as a community member looking in and hearing you all for years and years, it takes a village to make one decision, and it's not easy. But I think if we start maneuvering the right direction and we start strategizing and just, knocking the importance out and listening to the public, the community, and really bringing their voices into us and really starting to focus on this, I think we could really do amazing things.
Thank you very much. Yeah.
Thank you.
So I'd like to thank both applicants, because getting up and speaking like this in front of the board is quite something. So thank you both before we start deliberating. So we're going to all deliberate, and I think we are going to include you in that. So now is the deliberation part. Do you want to go first? Everybody's okay with that?
Yeah. Let's see if I can get this. All right, so.
Oh, turn the volume up. Oh, boy.
I did a little bit. Is that not good?
We'll bear with it. It's fine.
All right. So I know that I don't get an official vote, but before I leave, I do want to give an endorsement to Ms. Wetzel. I think that it is very important, like Mr. Ranson had said earlier, that there is Hispanic representation on the school board. I also believe that it is very crucial that she has not only gone through the school system herself, but that she has had two children, one in general ed and one in special ed, that have gone through it. I believe that she can provide a lot of insights, and she has proven that she has gone and supported the school system for a long time. I don't doubt Ms. Strackham's ability either, but I believe that Ms. Wetzel's perspectives could be crucial to the board.
Thank you very much.
And I do have to leave now because I have Miss Manchester tomorrow, so you already know how that goes.
We appreciate
I live
you,
that Louise. Every day.
So we'll bring it back to the board, and what do you guys think? I mean, it's just discussion amongst the four of us, and I mean, I'm just the facilitator. Somebody else started off.
This is one of the only times you have been met with silence. So I will ask the question, are we commenting now, but withholding like a choice or a vote at this time? What's the process here?
So the process is whatever the board chooses to do, but typically what it would be each individual board member would go and share their thoughts regarding just the process and their candidate that they're thinking would be they would vote for, and then from there have all four trustees share that, and you may find that there's some commonality, and then any one of you, preferably not the board president, would go and call for, make a recommendation and call for an action for one of the applicants.
Thank you for clarifying that.
And I just to add to that, it might make some sense. They are both very qualified candidates, so if we all want to call out the strengths of both candidates, that might make some sense.
I can start. I think both candidates are would be great board members. It's too bad we can't have both of them. But I think that, and I really appreciate the fact that we have two strong people. I think I would want to go with Catalina because of her long standing understanding of the community, Dunbar, of special needs, and also representing the Hispanic community. And I think that's one thing we are missing on the board that we would really benefit from.
So I will second that. I think they are both very qualified, and no doubt they would both do a fantastic job. I can tell from their answers and enthusiasm. So hopefully, however it goes, we can keep both involved, you know. But I think since the, 2016, I think, election, we have lacked a Latino representative on the board, and I know how important it is. I keep hearing it from not just the constituents at Dunbar, but how important it is that people feel that the board members have some lived experiences that reflect those of the school community that this board serves. And so having been a Dunbar parent, certainly a Sonoma Valley High School student, although, you know, it was a little bit of a different district then, but certainly a Dunbar parent in the very recent past and all the way through the special ed parent, and the ability to help us do a better job of outreach and connection to the Latino community, I think would be an asset. And again, I think Ms. Strachan has obviously a lot of energy and highly qualified, and definitely, no doubt, she would put all her best effort towards the position. So, but with that, I really think that I spoke to Judy Elliott briefly today, and one of the things that resonated for me as we're looking, knowing that we were coming into this tonight, it was just happened to be happenstance. You know, one of the things she said that we are needing to work on as a board, collectively as a district, is that we would have our own flesh and blood in any single classroom in this district, at any school, in any classroom. And that's what we're trying to work towards. And so with that, I think that that Catalina Wetzel would be, at least at my perspective, the best choice for this time right now.
I loved Jessica's answers about research and being prepared. People who have worked with me know that that's something that I hold very dear. I also believe that equity is perspective, and so I It's a difficult call for me. I had Catalina as a student when I taught at the high school, and it's been my distinct pleasure to watch you become such an amazing adult in our community, an amazing mom. And with a background in special education, we've shared many, many conversations around that. So in speaking with my board members, because I feel like equity is perspective, and we can really use another perspective on our board, I would need to be supportive of Catalina at this time.
So I'm going to mispronounce your name every time. I'm mistaken. You're a working mom. You help children. You were there 15 years ago in Nicole. No one can question your commitment. You have put in the time. You've been watching our history. You're aware of our budget issues. You have done the work. You've illustrated a continuing commitment to the schools. And for that, we are all in your debt. You know, noting the importance of fundraising, we never have enough money for all the things that we have to do. And I sense you are acutely aware of that, and it is incredibly valuable, and we need more people that are willing to put in the time and commitment like you have. Thank you for that. You said that our highest priority is our students. Yes, that absolutely nailed it. Completely correct. Okay. And then it's Catalina that you're sitting next to. And I mean, my daughter Allegra would never forgive me if I didn't vote for you, Catalina. She would never. And you know, you are a businesswoman. You have lived both our general education and our special education. You've seen us, you've lived a parent's dream with your son as a football star, and you have been there through some of the toughest stuff that our district has to offer in making sure that you fight for your son to get the education that he deserves. You know, as a Latina businesswoman in our community, you know, you have dealt with issues that most people never even are aware are there. And you see them all. And our community has changed. We used to say it's changed. And you understand where we have come from and where we are going. And I think that uniquely positions you to serve on our board. So I believe, you know, Ms. Wetzel, I think, but I want to acknowledge the strength of the candidates both. Thank you very much tonight.
So now it sounds like we are to call for a motion. And does this need to be a roll call vote? Okay. So I will make a motion that we do a roll call vote at this time.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Okay. Mr. Sylvie? Aye. I thought she just made a motion to appoint Ms. Wetzel.
I think she was thinking
was just, I was passing it off to you. I just said that it was time for a roll call vote.
And I seconded that it was. That's great, yeah.
We were so close.
All right, I'll make a motion then. I move that we appoint Ms. Catalina Wetzel as the Dunbar Area Trustee for the Sonoma Valley Unified School District. Is there a second?
I'll second that.
And based on prior discussions of the board, I think a call for a roll call vote. I think we could indicate that the motion was seconded by both Trustees Coleman and Johnson. Aye.
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 So that brings us to the next item on our agenda, which will be a swearing in. And Ms. Shields? We'll take a 5-minute recess at this time. Thank you.
Thank you.
So we're going to come back to our regular agenda, and we're going to be on item number 3, which is the sufficiency or insufficiency of instructional materials. And I will turn it over to Ms. Kaufman. Excuse me, Dr. Kaufman.
All right, this is an annual item. You need to open a public hearing about the sufficiency and insufficiency, and then I will address the board as an action.
So I'm going to open the public hearing on the sufficiency of textbooks and instructional materials. The hearing is hereby open at 7:39. And seeing no public comment, I close the hearing at 7:40.
So attached with the item, you have some background on our adopted textbook materials, and I will remind the board that the criteria is sufficient, meaning students have appropriate access. It is not like having the A+ or the Cadillac version. It is, do students have standard aligned materials in the high school programs? Do they have standard aligned materials in the elementary program? And is every student provided access? So I will say, however, that we have purchased additional instruction and instructional materials, particularly in science this year. And we purchased new world history texts for the high school as well. And of course, we're doing an ELA ELD adoption pilot right now. So we're on our way to becoming more sufficient.
So we are technically on item 4 at this point, because mm-hmm. we've opened and closed the hearing.
Yep.
So now let's take public comment on item 4, if there's any.
Celeste Winders, parent, and SEAC co-chair. So I know that we don't get the Cadillac, and I get that, but and I appreciate that there has been some things that's been worked into the reading lists that offer perspective, Latino perspectives and African-American perspectives. However, it is still an absolutely overwhelmingly Caucasian perspective on these reading lists. And I think that that's really shameful for a district that is predominantly students of color. The fact that that Huckleberry Finn is still on this list, I'm sorry, that book is racist as hell. Can we stop with it? I mean, it's still on the reading list. I appreciate that Zora Neale Hurston is on there. I appreciate there's a Maya Angelou book, but when you sprinkle one or two, and then you have this overwhelmingly European perspective in literature, I'm wondering if we've considered how that makes the majority of our students feel when overwhelmingly they're reading content that is not something that they can see themselves in. The beauty of literature is being able to read and see how you can see yourself and your perspective from the perspective of the author and seeing where you fit in that. And I'm not seeing a lot of that in this reading list. And as the parent of a student of color, my students are African American and Latino and Muslim. And there's not a lot of them in here for them to see pictures of themselves. And a lot of the work in here that does include African Americans is really based on slave narrative, as if that's the only narrative in African American literature and in African American culture. Our district doesn't recognize Black History Month every single year. I'm standing there screaming and yelling, what are we doing for Black History Month in February? And every year I walk around our school campuses and I see little to nothing. So the least we could do is really think about first-person perspective in the literature that our students are reading. And, you know, can we incorporate some Baldwin in here, where we would offer opportunities for LGBTQ students and our African-American students and all our other students to hear the perspective of a gay Black man writing in literature and learning a perspective that might be different from their own. But these lists are just a lot of the same stuff that I saw when I was there. I had to read Lord of the Flies 4 times in my Sonoma Valley Unified career. I hated that book. I mean, we're still reading Lord of the Flies. I mean, this is, at a certain point, we've got to be more culturally competent in the literature that we're providing and in the history books. I get we're talking textbooks, but these need to be first person indigenous, first person African-American, first person perspectives of Latino history. They're European perspectives of the history of people of color in this country. And it's just, it's offensive. It's got to stop. And so I hope moving forward as we look into the future that we really take a look at these lists and really decide whether we really want to be a culturally competent district or not.
Thank you, Ms. Winters. Ms. Hansen?
Janet Hansen, English Department Co-Chair Librarian at the high school. I wasn't planning to speak again tonight, but I think it's important that we all understand what we're looking at when we look at Williams Act material. I haven't seen these lists. I don't know how old they may be. I don't know how reflective they are of our current offerings at the high school. What I do know is that none of the novels we teach are covered by the Williams Act. So the fact that we do not have sufficient copies of the book to instruct the students that we wish to instruct in our newer titles is unfortunately not affected by the Williams Act. When we have a new title that is from the point of view of an autistic student and we can't get enough copies, even though we're down now to only 36 short, first we can't get it funded and then we can't get the order to go through. And then we hear understandable frustration from the public, but it doesn't show an awareness of the difficulty at the high school of finding the funding for the new titles that we very much desire to have. And I also suspect that these lists are out of date and incomplete. But just to remind everybody, unfortunately, Williams Act isn't relevant to our novels. It doesn't cover them.
Well, Helen Marsh, I looked at this list when I was going through the board packet, and I was, like Celeste and Mrs. Hansen, I was appalled. Well, I guess you're not appalled, you're complaining about the money. And I had asked Janet before the meeting what's going on, and she basically told me what she just said. But it's these lists, the high school list for novels is dated 2002, the middle school list is dated 2008. If they're not even up to date, what are they doing in the board packet? And there are a plethora of, you know, I have a grandson who's mixed race, African American and Anglo. And we read Black Lives Matter books. We've read LGBTQ books. We've read DACA-related books. There are so many books out there, and I'm not the one to decide what the best books are to teach. The English faculty should be, and the librarian tells me she can't. She wants 35 new books to have in the library. She doesn't have the money. So this novels are not that expensive, and it's just a travesty to me that these are many of the same books that I read, and I was in high school 50 years ago. So let's get with the program. And not only are they ethnocentric from an Anglo perspective, they're gender. The emphasis is on the male, the white male voice, rather than any other voice. And that it just, whether this list is accurate or not, is a problem. And but the accurate list is also not what the English department or what the library wants. And there's just no excuse for that. Thank you.
Any further public comment at this time? Okay, seeing none, we'll bring it back to the board. I just wanted to note before, for everyone, that the Williams requirement stems from the Williams settlement and requires that schools whose 2003-2004 school-wide API scores place them in deciles 1 to 3 during that school year must submit to the County Office of Education their instructional material audits, and Dunbar, El Verano, Flowery, Sassarini, and Altamira Middle were the ones that had to do that according to this. And we are approving, if I understand correctly, the audit from the county.
No, just a resolution on sufficiency.
On sufficiency,
which
okay.
we do annually. And the novels, just for your reference, the novels, we're trying to compile an accurate list of core curriculum, yeah. so the novels are included based on the district adopted list that we have available to us. And again, they are not covered by Williams, but we want to present the board both the core curriculum and at a later date the supplemental curriculum, because we want to see the comprehensive programs that we're offering.
But this is a settlement based on API scores from 15 years
ago. Long time ago.
And API scores don't even exist
nope.
anymore.
And okay. there's no way out.
So this is something of a zombie requirement
yes.
now. It's just going to keep shambling across our agenda every year.
Hopefully not, but yes, Kay. So far.
Any board questions? Any debate? Discussion? Would entertain a motion.
A resolution. Be a roll call.
I have a question, Elizabeth. So some of the dates, Houghton Mifflin, History, Social Studies, 2006, Health, Macmillan, 2005. Are these part of a regular sequence of adoptions? Are they part of an adoption cycle? That's my first question. And then the follow-up question is, do you anticipate the district looking at updating some of these that are, I mean, obviously, for example, the Health 2005 has got to be out of date by now.
Right. So I believe historically they have been part of an adoption cycle. I think in the moment we're kind of reconstructing that based on, at least in part, the ELA, ELD adoption, as it will cover a number of history, social science components, so we may not need to do a separate adoption, which would support our elementary teachers and the ability to focus and kind of not have to be pulled so many directions. We have purchased some supplemental materials to kind of fill in those gaps as well, so they're not on the core list. And again, like we're rolling science forward right now, and NGSS science for both middle school they're piloting and for high school. They're just going to keep adding a year of integrated science. So from those perspectives, we're in the process of updating them in a systematic way. And in terms of remedying, you know, other aspects of it.
If I could, for just a minute, too, just to remind the board that the state changed the way they fund materials. So where there used to be a categorical fund for instructional materials and a mandated state cycle of adoption, that went away several years ago. And so now there is no such said adoption timeline at the state level, and there is no money targeted just for materials. It is given in lump sum to districts, and they have to set it aside, and of course we have many competing interests for any dollar. So the thing we heard from most teachers and certainly from our scores that we knew we needed to address was the ELA, ELD adoption. And so that has been the priority while thinking about what money we could potentially invest in other smaller projects, but a more thorough once we get through the ELA adoption, and knowing that because it's one of the only classes that every student takes every year, their entire 13 or 14 years with us, if they go to TK1, that is our largest adoption cost materials-wise. So once we do that and look at kind of how we have funding left over, we can think then about the next series of adoptions to take place, because yes, many of these are very outdated and they need to be adopted and go through a very formal process.
And I know that with CASP and the Common Core Standards, there's literacy is sort of bound into every subject matter. So having an interest in hearing how that integration might be taking place, like you said, being able to blend literacy with social studies, or literacy with science, literacy with health, and maybe at some point hear a little bit about how that might help us inform our adoption cycles and the selections. But I completely hear what you're saying about needing ELA and ELD to be now.
And once we finish the elementary ELA, ELD adoption, we'll move to secondary. It's just when we looked at secondary, talked to secondary teachers last year, a big concern was students need to be able to read the materials that we have at our grade level. So, you know, let's fix the elementary and then figure out how to scaffold the next group of kids so that they can access the content and then go through a full-blown adoption. So that's another pending component, but we're not there yet.
And also there was a lag in materials being ready and being standards aligned when we switched to Common Core. Many of the published materials may have changed the cover or changed the table of content, but there was little change in the actual materials available, so there was a lag time in purchasing new materials. And in thinking about the kind of multicultural availability of our novels and what's in our libraries, I think that's one of the reasons why we moved to have a full-time librarian. This year we did increase...
And there is a library budget.
And we are working on creating a comprehensive annual way to look at what we have, how we update it, and what updating looks like in our community for our students so they do see themselves in the literature. So we agree that it is an important rallying cry for change, and we are incrementally, I do recognize people would love change faster. We're creating the position, the budget, the plan to move to something systematic across all our libraries. We have lots of library techs who work very hard with the humble things they have to create reading spaces, and we look forward to bringing that back.
So just, sorry, one last follow-up, and then I'll pass the torch along. So I realize that this is specific to Williams efficiency. So sorry, to talk to you and to talk to Socorro. I know, right.
You have to talk to me. Right.
But so the last question is, even though the Williams efficiency is focused on certain grade levels, as we talk about the Common Core adoption, I know that many times secondary settings would prefer adopting novels in a literature-based approach to English language arts as opposed to a quote-unquote boxed curriculum. So are there plans to include secondary lit materials as we talk about an ELA, ELD adoption?
I would say yes, we also need to look at the Common Core standards and what they say about percent of reading cross-disciplinary and make sure that our students, by the time they're seniors, are accessing literacy in all domains and covering expository and nonfiction texts predominantly in their high school experience. So that's a piece that we have to address, and that's part of the work we're doing at Sonoma State. But again, for students who are behind in literacy, we need to figure that out in multiple ways. And it may not be a novel explicitly that will serve a student who's coming in reading below grade level. So that's the conundrum of secondary schools. And you should all feel good because I am the mother of a child who's doing a 1999 series, world history. So I'm proud of us a little bit.
This is an action item.
Resolution.
Yep. Resolution. It's an action item that we adopt a resolution, correct? Okay. Is there a motion? Anyone want to move? It's to adopt resolution number 20-03.
Okay. I move that we adopt resolution number 20-03. Okay.
Is there a second?
I'll second.
Is this necessary to be a roll call vote? I believe. Okay. We're ready. Aye.
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 Aye. Mr. Abbott.
Hi, everyone. I have three items for you. No spreadsheets. So the first item is the letter from the county office on our budget that we submitted. It's a standard letter that they send to us, essentially approving our budget. Approving our close from last year, excuse me. And just to highlight a couple things, we did close with around $8 million in reserve, but they also point out that we're looking forward to some deficit spending. And of course, concerned about that, because even though it's nice to have money in the bank, if you start to spend deficits, then eventually you'll spend down that money. But all in all, it was a positive letter, and we appreciated getting that, that we were in good standing right now with the county. The second thing on here is, as a follow-up, we talked about this last month. So we are heading towards requesting what's called a categorical exception for the EIR at El Verano. We've worked with our attorney. You have his thinking in here. But what we want to do, even though we believe we have all the requirements for the, for requesting that, we're going to have a 20-day kind of open period with the El Verano community starting after today's board meeting with this official announcement. And we're going to have a community meeting at El Verano on October 16th, where we'll invite the community in. If they have concerns about this, then we will probably not go forward with this. And the idea will come back to you next board meeting with a request, assuming we do not get community have concerns about it, for requesting the categorical exception. So we're going to involve the community in the process, but we believe it is both the cost savings and we don't see a necessity. It is a building that is, you know, we're not going to affect the community much with just replacing a building that, you know, on a site, within a site. So we think we're good with that. The last one, and this is an action item, hiring bus drivers is a real struggle. We have been down bus drivers most of last year into this year. Our transportation manager regularly is out driving rather than managing. And one of the things that we think, we actually have some bus drivers that are considering working for us, but we have a constraint. In the CSEA contract, we are not allowed to hire someone coming in the door anything higher than step three. It's written into the contract. But the contract does allow the board to give us an exception to that. We've discussed this with CSEA. They are in favor of this, so we're requesting board approval that you allow us to go above step three for this year only. We'll revisit this if we need to, but so that we can, we believe we've got at least a couple hires we think we can get, but we want to see if this kind of improves things. So that's the only action item out of the three, and I'll take questions if there are any. But I'll step aside for a couple of comments.
And the board would take public comment at this time, and seeing none, we'll bring it back to the board. The board would entertain a motion. The chair would entertain a motion to approve hiring bus drivers at higher than step three at this time.
I'll move to approve that we hire bus drivers at, that we allow the hiring of bus drivers above step three.
I'll second.
All in favor indicate by saying aye.
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 Thank you. So approved. Thank you.
Yep.
Item six is the presentation of the initial proposal to VMTA.
Yeah. First, I'll apologize for our HR director. He's on a flight down to Southern California. He's going to the AXA HR conference, which we're very happy about, but he could not be here for a number of his items, so I'm going to stand in for him. So what we have in front of you is our essentially called the sunshining information. This is what we want to bring into negotiation with VMTA. Again, I want to kind of remind the board and the community that what's great about this year is that we're actually settled for this year. This is about next year's negotiation, because last year we did a two-year deal, which allows us to take this year and come to an agreement, build it into the budget, and then we can go forward. The articles here, we've been talking for some time about rethinking on the evaluation process. We want to talk about hours of employment. I think we both have interests on that side. Salary and salary placement, of course, looking at our benefits and our salary. With these, we can start negotiations. We expect VMTA will come back to you with their sunshining next month. But we plan on starting negotiations in October. We need this to move forward.
Is there public comment at this time? Okay. Seeing none, this is an information item. Discussion by the board.
Well, I just want to say thank you for starting this in October.
Yeah.
It was something you guys promised us last year you would do, and I'm glad to see you doing it. So.
Okay, seeing no further comment, go ahead, please.
You are fast on the button tonight.
I'm moving us along.
I know, but I actually had a question on the last one. So I'm gonna go back and tie them together so
sure.
that I'm within order. I also want to thank you for that, and And I wanted to note on that letter that you had been talking about from the county, where it said 1920 general fund reports total deficit spending of over $1 million. And then it says, even though the district meets minimum reserve requirements, the county office remains concerned about ongoing deficit spending. We urge the district to review and monitor revenues and expenditures. So jumping forward, as we talk about salary and health and welfare benefits, I just want us to be mindful of the fact that we are investing absolutely as much as we can in our employees. We need to send that message out and at the same time balance that out with the precautions coming from the county. Then my last question to you is, does VMTA also have four openers? I see we have four here. Yeah. So is it always four, or is it typically three and you extend it, or what's the scoop?
Last year we were negotiating after the contract had already expired with an open contract. And the intent was to do a lot of work in the contract because we had an open contract. We essentially ran out of time, and we were able to settle, and we both came to agreement, which is a good thing, wonderful thing. But in addition to that, we agreed to increase the number of openers for just this year to catch up with some of those things, clean up things we wanted to do. So that was an intentional one. Usually you have salary and benefits plus two would be a standard contract.
So item seven, sorry, I have to get back in the habit of pressing the talk button so it goes with the cameras. This is resolution 20-05, a provisional internship permit, and we're gonna have this one again, Mr. Abbott, correct?
Yes, I'm gonna be handling the HR ones. So this is a provincial PIP for, I'm terrible at pronunciations, Ed Aretha. I'm not even gonna try to pronounce it, you've got it written there. I'll just insult the name. Yeah. So this is so we can move forward with a special ed hire that we believe we need. Our very dutiful HR director did text me to remind me that the person is still receiving coaching through North Coast, so there'll be a lot of support given to this person. So again, sorry he couldn't be here, but he's helping me out along the way. He expected that as a question, so I thought I'd answer it.
Great, we'll take public comment at this time.
I deeply appreciate the work of our administrators and especially our transportation department that is transferring our special education students to their non-public school sites, which are spread all as far as Marin, Petaluma, Santa Rosa, Luna Park. However, a big piece of safety that isn't being addressed is the fact that we don't have aides on buses. And this is a big safety issue. These are students who have behavioral needs. These are students who have physical disabilities. These are students who don't always have hazard and safety awareness and who struggle with regulation and being patient and waiting, who are going on very long bus rides. I do encourage our trustees to take a bus ride sometime and take a bus ride with our non-public school students and see how long they sit on the bus and they travel. And what does a bus driver do when they have a student who has to go to the bathroom and doesn't have the ability to wait and hold it? Or a student who is having trouble regulating and is having a meltdown? Yeah. Or a student, you know, especially our students who are on the autism spectrum, where sensory overload is a very real and painful thing for them. Bus drivers are expected to drive the bus. They're expected to drive the bus safely. They're expected to navigate traffic and to stay on time and get our students on time. But what do they do and what kind of training do they have? And could they even manage that while also keeping all the other students on the bus safe and getting the bus to and from school safely? And what happens is, as parents, we get the phone call that your child blew up on the bus. And maybe your child can't take the bus. And then, well, you have to get my kid to school because you got to give them FAPE, so what are you going to do?
you know, and we have students who, you know, whose parents are driving them to and from school, not because they have the capability to or that they even want to, but because their student can't ride the bus because of their behavioral needs. And what are we doing about that? So this is very much a safety issue. This is a safety issue that our special education parents has brought to this board many, many times over. And we will continue to bring it. And I think that this week is a really good week to have that conversation. And I really want to encourage you as trustees, if you can this week for School Bus Safety Week, to hop on one of those buses and ride yourselves to a non-public school and to see what that trip really looks like for the bus driver and for the students. Remember, we want our students to get to school ready to learn, but if they've been on the bus and they just had a meltdown and they just had to go pee for 40 minutes and the bus driver couldn't stop and maybe they had an accident, they're arriving at school with an accident. And what does that mean for starting your educational day? Are you ready for learning? So these are some things I really want you to think about safety, but I actually want you to do something about them as well.
Thank you, Celeste.
Could I answer?
Not yet. It's the hardest part. I did want to tag team on that and say that our transportation department does do a really good job. My child doesn't currently ride on the white fleet or any of the buses, but she has. And I think one of the things that happens is when we do hear negative things about the transportation, it's not because our bus drivers are terrible, and it's not because something has gone wrong, but it's because there's that one missing element. Like my child used to get naked every day on the bus. This is what happens. I mean, you know, like, and so she would come home naked. And I can't be mad at the bus driver. I'm just glad I got her there safe, right? But she would throw her shoes at people. This is not an ideal situation. And that bus driver got a lesson, right? I mean, he got her there, but so when we hear complaints, I just always want to kind of bring it back. We do. We have a really amazing transportation department, but we get a lot of complaints. Or I, as a you know, people call me and they're transportation. Well, it's not the drivers. It's not transportation. They really think that it's kind of like the job of the powers that be, you guys, to put all of the right people in place outside of drivers. So.
I do have to comment on this one. My child has been transported for the past 3 weeks every day to Sebastopol, and we've been having a tremendous positive experience. So I'm really grateful for that. And so as I was hearing Celeste and Mindy talk about the challenges that some of the drivers are sometimes the criticism or negative. Things that we oftentimes may be hearing from people is really not about the drivers and about the support that oftentimes these drivers need. It's sort of related to the previous conversation that we had about the potential hire, which I'm not going to talk about. But what we really want to talk about is specifically what they were talking about is really leadership, right? And I think that like over and over, we keep on hearing this sort of theme. It's about leadership. It's about support. It's how people are being guided to do the job right. It really comes down to you guys as a board. It's really you guys really having the ability to really have profound discussions and understanding the issues. That's really what it comes down to. So it's concerning when we don't have a board that is able to really dive deep into the issues and really honestly have honest conversation instead of sugarcoating. And then on that note too, it's like what type of conversation we're having with the administration as well too. And the leadership there as well too. You know, again, going back to the comments about the concerns that we have on the administration and the cabinet and how they're responding, what type of support they're getting to the sites, to the teachers, to the bus drivers. And again, you know, it really reflects on you. The same way that it reflects on how my children behave when they're not with me as a parent. That's really what it comes down to. So just think about that. Thank you.
Any further public comment? Okay. See, we'll bring it back to the board.
Recently, I had an experience with my son. Back in May, he started having seizures, and out of the blue, he had two. And when I say it takes a village, I mean it takes the board and the community too. And I get it, being a parent, you know, in how you're feeling. But I do feel The high school was amazing. They jumped, the nurse at the high school jumped right on it. And, you know, they called me up and they said, what can we do for you? And I said, you know, my concern is what happens if Gino has a seizure on the bus? Is that bus driver educated, you know, CPR? What would they do? Like, I need to know the protocol. And she says, you know, we have not trained them for that. And I said, but there are students at the high school that have seizures, not on the spectrum and every, you know, so what happens if that happens? And she said, well, you know, we'll have to talk about that. But she goes, let me talk to my, whoever she had to talk to. And she came back the next day and she said, you know, we're gonna hire an LVN. And although it's gonna take a little time, so, you know, are you willing to help us through this? And I said, of course, he is my son. I will do whatever it takes to be a team player. So what I did, until they hired a nurse, I hopped on that bus. And I went on the bus with my son to the high school, and then I had somebody pick me up. Why? Because he's my son, and I'm gonna work with the school. I can't expect the school to do everything. And when I say it takes a village, it takes the parents and the school to work together. That is how I view that. I do get it that we are bus drivers. There has to be a little education because there is a lot. There's diabetes, there's what happens if a child's sugar level, you know, drops or they go into a diabetic attack. There's so many things in the medical side that maybe need to be addressed. So I do hear you. I do understand that worry. But I also, as a parent, you do whatever it takes to help the situation.
Coming back to the resolution, I remember students coming off of the bus in the morning. And I remember talking to parents at the very end of the day. And our bus drivers can make that day for that child. I've watched so many children get off of the bus smiling and happy, or they had a problem with another child, and this happens to all children. And they said, oh, but the bus driver helped me that day. So I know that we always have a ways to go down that road in terms of improving our transportation and getting all of the support that we need on those buses for those drivers. I 100% agree that their job is to drive and get them there safely. And I've also watched bus drivers who literally have eyes in the back of their heads with the music playing and kind words for the children, and they manage to help soothe the disagreements that can sometimes happen between the children on the bus. So I want to thank them and all of their support staff down at the bus barn for all of the work that they're doing to make sure our kids get there safe. And I would like to see us bring back at another time those conversations about ways to support our bus drivers with training, whether it's for the special ed drivers or the gen ed drivers, and talk some more about ways to get support onto those buses. So, thank you.
So, my kids ride the bus every day. I don't know how long it's been since we had another trustee that elementary age kids ride the bus, but it's been a while. It's been a long time. I actually do know exactly what happens when a kid has an accident on the bus. And that would be only a bunch of times. Little girls, first graders, second graders. Bus drivers are amazing. I was going to joke, Superintendent Shields, with you that when you described the bus driver you were riding with as such a nice person, and if word gets out about Mean Mike like that, it's going to ruin his reputation that he's such a nice guy. Which, of course, he is. He's a very nice man. And they're wonderful folks. And so I thought I would read off their names, just like I did with the administrators, so you know what you say. So it's, it is Vernice Bruno, Michelle Bugahalian Silky, Yvonne Sinclair, Cheryl Anderson, Walter Bettis Jr., Christine Brecht, Miranda Fulkerson, Edwin Hidalgo, Ishmael Gonzalez, Richard Ponting, Michael Turpin, Annette Albini,
Ishmael Gonzalez Jr., Michael Martin, Marcel Moreno, Joshua Savick, Felice Torrey, Peter Chiara, Andrew Beauty, and Stacey Adu. And with that, the chair will entertain a motion.
I move to approve.
I'll second.
And this is a roll call.
Trustee Britt?
Aye.
Trustee Foreman?
Aye.
Trustee Wetzel?
Aye.
Trustee Johnson?
Aye.
And Trustee Kelly?
Aye. Okay. Nice work, guys. So we still have one last item.
So this is the Williams quarterly uniform complaint. Any complaints we have related to instructional materials, facilities, instructor teacher vacancies, incorrect assignments, and we have reported action. We've had zero complaints in this quarter.
All the comment. Okay, seeing none, bring it back to the board. Trustee comment? Question? Okay, this, I don't see a resolution attached to the item, but it looks like it's an action item.
It's an action.
Okay, but this does not require a roll call, it's not a resolution, correct? Okay, yeah. So chair, entertain a motion.
I move to approve.
Is there a second?
A second.
All in favor?
Aye.
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 Opposed?
Okay. So that brings us to trustee reports.
Well, in the spirit of Trustee Kelly moving this meeting along, I will abstain. I don't really have a report other than I think we had a great open house for the high school this year. And it's really great to see, even though we do have new administration there, how he's stepping right in. And I think, overall, in spite of the fact that there's been a change, I think there's great momentum happening there. And I'm hearing that from parents and students as well. So, and then I just want to say two things, mainly for the public. Thing number one is, we've been doing these Masters in Governance courses as a board so that we can all become better board members. And one of the things that is part of our learnings is that, if we already have our questions answered, we don't necessarily need to re-ask them at the meeting. If another board member has said something we agree with, in the effort to actually accommodate more business, getting more business done, we don't need to reiterate what someone else said that we agree with. And that if a board member isn't commenting or speaking, it doesn't mean that they're not doing their job. In fact, it is doing a better job so that we can actually accommodate more work. And then also the other thing I think is important, I think a lot of people don't understand this, and I think it's just something that I want to say, that when members of the public or community members, teachers, people write to a board member, unless it's about an individual student or about a personnel issue, anything anyone writes to us is public information. And can be summoned by a Public Records Act. And I think a lot of people don't understand that as public employees, we are required that our all the information, it's the reason we use our trustee emails as opposed to our personal emails. So I just think it's something important, and I think a lot of people don't really understand that. So thanks.
I appreciated taking a walk with Stuart Saunders recently and learning a lot more about the field, and appreciate all your work on that and keeping it in front of us. And yes, as Britta said, we've all spent a lot of time this month. It's been a big school board month. The meetings in Santa Rosa, I think we got a lot out of them and got to know each other better. And the back to school nights were great. And tag along with Melanie, who knew lots of people, and that was fun.
I attended a ton of back-to-school nights, more than I can count. I have enormous sympathy for all the parents who are struggling to get to school right now with all the bridge closures in the valley. One thing I would like us to try to do is to, if we can, allow parents to get excused absences due to construction. They're marking these as tardies and constant. I think it might calm down some parents who are struggling on back roads at high speed to get to school on time. It's more important to be safe, and let's, you know, recognize that we're property rights under the district. And I'll leave it at that for now.
And I just want to say thank you so much. This is such a great honor to be on this board. I'm really excited to hopefully help and push things forward and assist in what we can do.
Welcome aboard, Catalina.
Thank you.
Wonderful having your voice. I really look forward to working with you as a new board member.
Thank you.
So we had two information staff reports that were on the agenda tonight, and if a trustee wanted to bring them back as an informational item on the regular agenda, we can do so. This would be a great time to ask for them if you'd like to. And this is also the time when we propose future agenda items, and I'd like to bring back an item on school maintenance and an item on district elections.
Sure, and just as a reminder, we have a study session this Saturday in the same room at 9 o'clock, starting in the morning, ending probably at noon. And so we might be able to wrap some of what was in those items. Normally, when we, at least last year when we did the summer school report, remember that we would have the summer school principals here and recognizing kind of a fluid time structure with our first bundle of items. That's why we
Yes, I would like to please request the summer school reports. I think it's important to hear from them and how that's going.
Thank you.
Okay, so seeing no other items, I would note that it is 8:57. We had set adjournment for 9 o'clock.
3 minutes early.
Touch and go there.
I'm going to talk to them. I'm sorry about that, but I still have leftover. Now I'm going to go shoot.
my daughter's feeling everything in life and checking it done. And it's my fault. So that you get to have a picture. Yeah,
I have an
so,
yeah, my cousin was called with her 14-year-old. She said she's going to go live with her dad because her mom's on her phone number.
Look at this.
Yeah, that's